Time Warner Audiobooks presents Lifeguard, written by James Patterson and Andrew Gross, and read by Billy Campbell.
Part 1, The Perfect Score. Chapter 1.
"Don't move," I said to Tess, sweaty and out of breath. "Don't even blink. If you so much as breathe, I know I'm gonna wake up, and I'll be back lugging deck chairs at poolside, staring at this gorgeous girl that I know something incredible could happen with. This will all have been a dream."
Tess McAuliffe smiled, and in those deep blue eyes, I saw what I found so irresistible about her. It wasn't just that she was the proverbial 10 and a half. She was more than beautiful. She was lean and athletic, with thick auburn hair plaited into a long French braid, and a laugh that made you want to laugh too. We liked the same movies: Memento, The Royal Tenenbaums, Casablanca. We pretty much laughed at the same jokes. Since I'd met her, I'd been unable to think about anything else. Sympathy appeared in Tess's eyes. "Sorry about the fantasy, Ned, but we'll have to take that chance. You're crushing my arm." She pushed me, and I rolled onto my back. The sleek cotton sheets in her fancy hotel suite were tousled and wet. My jeans, her leopard print sarong, and a black bikini bottom were somewhere on the floor. Only a half an hour earlier, we'd been sitting across from each other at Palm Beach's Tony Cafe Boulou, picking at DB burgers, $30 a piece, ground sirloin stuffed with foie gras and truffles. At some point, her leg brushed against mine. We just made it to the bed. "Ah," Tess sighed, rolling up onto her elbow. "That feels better." Three gold Cartier bracelets jangled loosely on her wrist. "And look who's still here." I took a breath. I patted the sheets around me. I slapped at my chest and legs as if to make sure. "Yeah," I said, grinning. The afternoon sun slanted across the Bogart suite at the Brazilian Court Hotel, a place I could barely have afforded a drink at. Forget about the two lavishly appointed rooms overlooking the courtyard that Tess had rented for the past 2 months. "I hope you know, Ned, that this sort of thing doesn't happen very often," Tess said, a little embarrassed, her chin resting on my chest. "What sort of thing is that?" I stared into those blue eyes of hers. "Oh, whatever could I mean? Agreeing to meet someone I'd seen just once on the beach, for lunch, coming here with them in the middle of the day?" "Oh, that," I shrugged. "Seems to happen to me at least once a week."
"It does, huh?"
She dug her chin sharply into my ribs. We kissed, and I felt something between us begin to rise again. The sweat was warm on Tess's breasts, and delicious, and my palm traveled up her long, smooth legs and over her bottom. Something magical was happening here. I couldn't stop touching Tess. I'd almost forgotten what it was like to feel this way. Split aces, they call it, back where I'm from. South of Boston, Brockton, actually. Taking a doubleheader from the Yankees, finding a forgotten $100 bill in an old pair of jeans, hitting the lottery. The perfect score.
"You're smiling," Tess looked at me, propped up on an elbow. "Wanna let me in on it?"
"Ah, it's nothing. Just being here with you. You know what they say. For a while now, the only luck I've had has been bad luck." Tess rocked her hips ever so slightly, and as if we had done this countless times, I found myself smoothly inside her again. I just stared into those baby blues for a second, in this posh suite, in the middle of the day, with this incredible woman, who only a few days before hadn't been conceivable in my life.
"Well, congratulations, Ned Kelly."
Tess put a finger to my lips.
"I think your luck's beginning to change."
Chapter 2. I had met Tess 4 days before on a beautiful white sand beach along Palm Beach's North Ocean Boulevard. Ned Kelly is how I always introduced myself. Like the outlaw. Sounds good at a bar, with a rowdy bunch crowded around, except no one but a couple of beer-drinking Aussies and a few Brits really knew whom I was talking about. That Tuesday, I was sitting on the beach wall after cleaning up the cabana and pool at the estate house where I worked.
I was the part-time pool guy, part-time errand runner for Mr. Saul Roth, Solly to his friends. He had one of those sprawling Florida-style homes you can see from the beach north of the breakers and maybe wonder, whoa, who owns that? I cleaned the pool, I polished up his collection of vintage cars from ragtops, ran his dry cleaning, even sometimes played a few games of gin with him around the pool at the end of the day. He rented me a room in the carriage house above the garage. Solly and I met at Taboo, where I waited tables on weekend nights. At the time, I was also a part-time lifeguard at Midtown Beach. Solly, as he joked, made me an offer I couldn't refuse. Once upon a time, I went to college, tried real life, even taught school for a while back up north until that fell apart. It would probably shock my pals here that I was once halfway to a master's in social education at BU. A master's in what, they'd probably go? Beach management? So I was sitting on the beach wall that beautiful day. I shot a wave to Miriam, who lived in the large Mediterranean next door, who was walking her Yorkies, Nicholas and Alexandria, on the beach. A couple of kids were surfing about 100 yards offshore, and I was thinking I'd do a run-swim-run, jog about a mile up the beach, swim back, then run hard, up and back, all the while watching the ocean. Then, like some dream, there she was, in a great blue bikini, ankle-deep in surf, her long reddish-brown hair knotted up in a twist with a flutter of tendrils. Right away, it was as if there was something sad about her, though. She was staring vacantly at the horizon. I thought she was dabbing her eyes. I had this flash, the beach, the waves, the pretty, lovelorn girl, like she was going to do something crazy, on my beach. So, I jogged down to her, in the surf. Hey! I shielded my eyes and squinted into that gorgeous face. If you're thinking what I think you are, I wouldn't advise it. Thinking what? She looked up at me, surprised. I don't know, I see a beautiful girl on the beach, dabbing her eyes, staring forlornly out to sea. Wasn't there some kind of movie like that? She smiled, and that's when I could see for sure she'd been crying. You mean where the girl, on a hot afternoon, goes in for an afternoon swim? Yeah, I said with a shrug, suddenly a little embarrassed. That's the one. She had a thin gold chain around her neck and a perfect tan. An accent, maybe English? God, she was a knockout. Guess I was just being cautious. I didn't want any accidents on my beach. Your beach, she said, glancing up at Solly's. Your house too, I guess. She smiled, clearly toying with me. Sure. You see that window above the garage? Here, you can see it. I shifted her. Through the palms, if you lean this way. And like an answer to my prayers, I got her to laugh. Ned Kelly, I stuck out my hand. Ned Kelly? Like the outlaw? I did a double take. No one had ever said that to me. I just stood there with a dumbass, starstruck grin. Don't think I even let go of her hand. Sydney, New South Wales, she said, displaying her Aussie strawn, her accent. Boston, I grinned back. And that was how it started. We chatted a little more about how she'd been living there for a couple of months and how she'd take long walks on the beach. She said she might come back this way the next day, and I said there was a chance I might be there too. As I watched her walk away, I figured she was probably laughing at me behind those $400 Chanel sunglasses. By the way, she said, suddenly turning, there was a movie, Humoresque, with Joan Crawford. You should check it out. I rented Humoresque that night, and it ended with a beautiful heroine drowning herself by walking into the sea. And on Wednesday, Tess came back, looking even hotter in this one-piece suit and a straw hat. She didn't seem sad. We took a swim, and I told her I would teach her how to body surf, and for a while she went along. And then as I let her go, she hopped the right wave and crested in like a pro. She laughed at me from the shore. I'm from Australia, silly. We have our Palm Beach too, just past Whale Beach, north of Sydney. We made a date for lunch at the Brazilian court in 2 days. That's where she was staying, one of the most fashionable places in town, a few blocks off of Worth Avenue. Those 2 days were like an eternity for me. Every ring of my cell phone I figured was her canceling.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.